Now, I imagine, given its shape, if I were to give you a map of England and ask you to find the exact geographical centre of it, you might find it rather tricky. But thanks to some very clever cartographers, I am standing on that exact point. I'll tell you exactly where I am in just a moment. On today's house search, character features kindle the country dream.
Nice log burner for you.
I think that could be good at Christmas, yeah.
Christmas, every week, come home, that commute home.
But which of our three properties will get the warmest reaction?
Wow. This is lovely.
That's fantastic.
And two fireplaces.
Big ingle nook, and then you've got your log burner as well.
Fantastic.
Today, I'm in Leicestershire in the East Midlands, just outside the village of Fenny Drayton. Now, in 2002, Ordnance Survey conducted some rather complex calculations to work out that this spot is smack bang in the middle of England. And that took the crown from the nearby village of Meriden, which had for over 500 years claimed to be the geographical heart. It's just one of the surprising claims to fame that this region has to offer. The East Midlands is comprised of six counties, and it's the region's southern counties of Rutland, Leicestershire and Northamptonshire we're exploring today. Several towns here boast impressive historic buildings alongside quaint residential dwellings in the rural villages. And throughout the region, richly coloured local ironstone is a recurrent architectural feature. At the heart of England's smallest county, Rutland, lies the largest reservoir in the country. Rutland Water is a popular spot for fishing and water sports, and its 25-mile perimeter attracts cyclists and walkers. In the neighbouring county of Leicestershire, the Georgian town of Market Harborough has held a weekly market since 1221. Its grammar school, built in 1614, was constructed on stilts to create a shelter for market traders. Further south, the Northamptonshire village of Stoke Bruin on the Grand Union Canal remains largely unchanged since the 19th century heyday of the canals. With its rich history and natural beauty, the East Midlands provides a country escape with plenty to discover.
Buying a rural property in the East Midlands can offer excellent value for that life-changing move. Across the whole of the region, the average price of a detached property is just under £263,000, which is around £70,000 below the national figure. And in the southerly counties, particularly Northamptonshire, you can find some very desirable towns within just an hour's commute of the capital. But you can expect to pay a premium for a postcode in those. Today's buyers are amongst that commuter crowd, looking a little further afield for their ideal country retreat.
Our house hunters are husband and wife duo, Victoria, who currently works as an HR manager, and Tristram, who's the head of communications for an energy company. They have an 18-month-old son, William, and live in suburban Bromley, southeast London. Their converted Victorian flat is the first property they bought together 4 years ago.
We met at work 6 years ago?
Something like that, 6 years ago.
I'd only been in the company about 2 weeks when Tristram plucked up the courage to ask me out.
We got on quite well straight away and that was that.
Although Bromley has been a perfect home for this young family so far, Victoria and Tristram don't see it as their forever home.
At the moment, we're in a first floor flat. It's very beautiful. We've got a lovely garden, but it's a bit of an expedition to get outside. So it'd be really lovely to be in a house where we can throw open some double doors and just have him running in and out of the house all summer.
Since William came along, we don't need and we don't use all the conveniences of South London. You know, when we were a younger couple on our own, it was great to have everything on our doorsteps. But actually now it's much more important to have perhaps a bit more space, a slightly bigger garden, countryside to go and play in.
Inspired by Victoria's own idyllic childhood, they've decided to leave the busy city behind them and move to her home county of Leicestershire.
Living in London, you do get caught up in the rush, the pressure, everything being busy. I've always lived in South London and I've loved it. It's been a great way to grow up. But equally, I think I'm ready for a change. And the way Victoria talks about growing up in the countryside means I'm really excited for that for William.
I grew up in a small village in rural Leicestershire, so I think I always thought that it would be really nice to raise a family like that.
Whilst this East Midlands move will be a homecoming for Victoria, for Londoner Tristram, it will herald a completely new lifestyle.
Victoria always tells me that I don't actually know what it's going to be like living in the countryside, that I can't get a takeaway delivered at 3 a.m. So I think maybe I've got a learning curve to go through.
Once Tristram adjusts to country life, there will be plenty of opportunities for all the family.
I think as William gets older and we start to see a little bit more about what he's into, what his interests are, not being in suburban London perhaps gives him a little bit more scope, more things he can try. You know, maybe he'll be sporty and outdoors, maybe he won't, but it'd be nice for him to have the opportunity.
It'll be really nice being back in the countryside. There'll be a lot of space for William to play, lots of family activities for us to go and do. In Leicestershire, there's a lot of National Trust properties, a lot of history, so I'm sure we'll be able to take William out and visit some of those things while we're there.
The East Midlands is ideally located, bringing them closer to Victoria's parents, whilst also providing good transport links back to Tristram's office.
I work full-time in London, I want to keep the same job. That's completely possible because you can live in the Midlands and the train links get you straight back in, so no reason to change, but can get all the benefits of living in the countryside.
Victoria is hoping to take a few years off work whilst raising their family, but she already has lots of ideas to keep herself busy.
I grew up with chickens and ponies and geese, so it would be really lovely to have some farm animals, maybe some chickens. I'm trying to convince Tristram to let me have a pig.
I'll be happy with the chicken. We can discuss the pig.
Taking Victoria closer to her parents in the northwest of Leicestershire, our property search will extend across Leicestershire, Northamptonshire and Rutland to ensure Tristram has a reasonable train journey for his commute to London. I'm meeting up with them to find out more about their exact requirements.
Victoria, Tristram, great to see you. Beautiful part of the country you've decided to move to.
Yeah, it's fantastic and it's really close to my family, beautiful outdoors, countryside, and we're really looking forward to moving here.
And not too far to commute to work?
No, really manageable routes back into London, giving the best of both worlds.
So this house, what are we looking for in this dream property of yours?
4 to 5 bedrooms, hopefully, and ideally a big kitchen diner is really important. A nice garden, plenty of space outdoors, preferably some space maybe for some animals. Ideally a playroom, if that's possible, and some space for a home office as well for when Tristram works from home.
Definitely. And I think for me, it's got to have charm, it's got to have character. I need to love my home. I don't mind new homes, I don't mind older homes, I don't mind conversions. But I think whatever it is, it's got to be a great example of that type of home.
Now, what about community? Are we looking in this move to be quite isolated or right in the centre of a village? What would you like?
It is a move to the country. We want to feel like we're in the countryside, but equally, we couldn't have no neighbours. We need to have people around us, people who we can get to know, hopefully other children for our kids to play with as they grow up. So edge of town, edge of village, that blend, I think.
So for this big move at this point in your life, remind me of your budgets.
We're aiming for £650,000.
Well, we have three fantastic properties to show you, so shall we get looking?
Great.
Absolutely. Okay.
For a maximum budget of £650,000, Victoria and Tristram are looking for a character property with space for their growing family. That includes a kitchen diner and at least 4 bedrooms. A playroom for their son, an office for Tristram, and a large garden are also high on their priorities. But location is key, as they want community and good rail connections to London. We have 3 beautiful potential homes to serve up, but the price tag won't be revealed until the end of each house tour. The final property will be our mystery house, and it could offer everything they want and so much more if they're prepared for some hard graft. We're beginning our property search in Northamptonshire, heading to the village of Middleton. This attractive village on the fringes of the Welland Valley is lined with impressive Victorian and Georgian architecture. There's an active community here, a good primary school and a popular pub. All this is just a 10-minute drive to fast rail connections from Corby to the capital. In the very heart of the village, the property we've come to see certainly makes a statement, even in the rain. So that is our first property.
Oh, fabulous.
Very nice.
It's really pretty. It's very symmetrical.
Liking the look of that?
Yeah, really nice. I like the ivy.
It's elegant. It looks like it's a good size, which is really important. Nice and central in the village. I think that's lovely.
Excited to see it.
Should we get straight in there?
Yeah.
OK, excellent. Come this way.
This classic red brick Victorian property, topped with slate, was originally built in 1862 and was extended further in the 1890s. It was one of three pubs in the village in the 19th century, but was converted to residential use in the 1960s.
So through that big entrance hall, which is a lovely welcome home.
Wow.
Into what would be your kitchen diner.
Nice. It's very modern.
Feels a little bit small for me. Personally, I'd hope for something a bit more open.
A shame it doesn't have access onto the garden. That would improve it.
I was thinking you have a beautiful dining room behind this kitchen.
Yeah.
But what you could do, take this wall down, pop a steel in there, and then create a beautiful kitchen diner and maybe investigate double doors out into your garden.
Yeah, perfect.
If we just look at it as a space that we can use creatively, there's a whole realm of possibilities.
So should we see more?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, follow me. So come through.
Oh, wow.
Into your main living space.
Really big, loads of space. And nice to have the windows on both sides as well.
And still character everywhere, the ceiling roses, the whole feeling of the house. It's spacious and elegant, but it's still got such charm about it.
Nice log burner for you.
I think that could be good at Christmas, yeah.
Christmas, every evening, come home, that commute home. And is this a kind of good size for you in terms of raising a family, thinking of your family growing?
Space for us to have a kind of more formal end as well. We could have kind of a play area at one side, definitely.
You don't need a play area at one side because behind this space, there is a beautiful playroom.
Oh, wow.
And the kids can do whatever, they can make as much mess as they like and you can shut the door on it.
We'll draw all over the walls and make all sorts of mess.
Would you like to see more?
Yeah, definitely.
OK, let's head upstairs.
With the additional playroom, I sense that Victoria and Tristram are already seeing the advantages this home could provide for their growing family. Further down the central hallway is a handy utility room with separate WC. Upstairs, there are four large bedrooms, so plenty of space for family and visiting friends, plus a family bathroom. We're heading to the master.
Brown.
Lovely.
It's nice and big.
It's really, I like the way the window drops almost down to the floor. Lets the light flood in, doesn't it?
So enough storage for you?
Yeah. Me who needs the storage, isn't it, I think.
Oh, you're the clothes man in the family.
Yeah, I need more than half the wardrobe.
Yeah, he has more wardrobe than me.
There is an ensuite to this master bedroom.
Lovely. Perfect.
Works for you?
It does, yeah. I think our bed is a little bit bigger than that, so we'd just have to work out whether there was space for bedside tables, but it looks like there would be.
It's calm, it's relaxing, it works. It's not tugging my heartstrings yet, but it ticks a lot of boxes. And actually, maybe this is a point of our life when we need boxes ticked.
Tristram is thinking very practically about this property, and I think that outdoors offers more that will suit their needs. Particularly with an office space which could be perfect for home working. There's also a good-sized lawn and a gated driveway providing off-street parking.
You get a really good view of just how big the property is here.
It's fantastic. And it's very safe for children and cats to be in. They're not getting out anywhere.
It's really private as well. I think, you know, you're not overlooked. It's really your own space to be yourself. It's perhaps not the biggest garden, but what there is lovely and it's really well laid out, and I think you could do a lot with it.
Time to talk price. What do you think this property is on the market for?
I think it's top of our budget. I think £640,000.
Tris, what do you think?
I think it's probably slightly over budget. I think it's probably £675,000.
This is bang on your budget at £650,000.
It's good. It's good. It's a lot of house for the money.
Well, knowing the price now, why don't you take another look around and we'll catch up in a moment.
Great. Thank you.
And £650,000, this beautiful detached 19th century home is full of character and space, with no less than four reception rooms and four bedrooms. It also boasts a private walled garden and lies just a short drive from good train links to London.
I really like this house. It's big, it's got lots of lovely period features, it's got all the rooms we want. At the moment, the kitchen and the dining room are separate, and I don't think that would work for us longer term. I think we'd probably want to create one big space there.
This is certainly a house I could live in and be very happy. It's a great family home, and I know that bringing up kids here would be fantastic. I'm not quite sure if the flow of it works in the way that I'd want my house to be, but it's certainly very nice.
The location is absolutely perfect. The village is really pretty. There's obviously a lot going on, which is great when you've got young kids.
Hi, all done?
Yes.
Yeah.
Definitely seen enough?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right, on to the next one.
Victoria and Tristram are looking forward to exploring the historic sites of the East Midlands with their son William when they make their move. Today we've arranged for them to visit a jewel in Leicestershire's architectural landscape, Beaver Castle. Built by James Wyatt, who also built the castle at Windsor, it's a magnificent example of the Regency-era Gothic style. Historian Madeline Strongman is a tour guide at this stately home, which has been the ancestral seat of the Dukes of Rutland for some 500 years.
So how old is the castle?
Well, there's actually been a castle on this site since 1066, but this castle, in fact, is the fourth castle that's been on this site.
And what was the reason for the first castle? Why a castle here?
It all started with William the Conqueror, conquered the country, carved huge chunks of the country up and gave it to anyone that had done him a good service. One of those lucky recipients was called Robert de Todini, and William the Conqueror awarded him the lands around here. So he came up the hill and built his first castle.
So, to me, it seems it's spelt Belvoir but pronounced Beaver.
Well, when Robert de Todini first arrived here, of course, he was French. And he came up to the top of the hill and he said in French, Quel Belvoir, what a beautiful view. But, of course, the locals couldn't speak French, so they mispronounced it as Beaver. And it's just remained a tradition ever since then.
The current facade of Beaver Castle was the vision of Elizabeth, the fifth Duchess of Rutland. She decided to put her own stamp on the building during the 19th century and set about creating the castle of her dreams. Over the centuries, it's received many distinguished guests, including royalty.
So what have these rooms been used for?
Well, these rooms are actually, it's a suite of three rooms we call the King's Rooms. They were largely set aside for the sole use of the then Prince Regent, who became George the Fourth, and he was a very good friend of the fifth Duke and Duchess. So he used to come up here to get away from Windsor and spend some time with his very great friends, which is why they're certainly decorated in his very flamboyant taste with all these exotic wallpapers and this very sort of gaudy yellowy gold. But the thing that astounds most people when they come in here is, of course, how high the bed is. It was a bed that was built for a king, and a king cannot be looked down upon. So they were worried that when the valet came in the morning with his early morning cup of tea, his valet would be looking down on the king. So the answer to that is to heighten the bed. The other interesting thing, of course, is the Prince Regent's bathroom. Because the Prince Regent was quite a big, big man, unfortunately one side of the corridors had to be carved out so that he could actually get his stomach down the corridor.
Over the years, all the duchesses who have lived at Beaver have made their own mark on the castle's vast gardens. Upon the recent discovery of long-lost landscape designs by Capability Brown, the current Duchess began an extensive restoration of the gardens in line with the plans from 1780 and opened to the public in 2016. But it's the Rose Garden which was created at the turn of the 20th century where Madeline is taking our couple.
So here we are in our beautiful rose garden.
Wow, they're fantastic. Who created the rose garden?
Well, the rose garden was actually created by the 8th Duchess Violet in 1906.
And how big's the estate as a whole?
The estate at the moment is about 16,000 acres, so it's quite some size. Yeah.
So this is just one part of the garden. What are the rest of the gardens like?
Well, they are actually quite extensive. Obviously, we've got the statue garden a bit further down. We've got the Japanese gardens. Further afield, we've got the Duchess's garden. But you're welcome to go off and have a little look around our beautiful rose garden, especially the weather we've got today.
It's beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you.
After taking in some of Beaver Castle's heritage and splendour, it's time for our buyers to return to their search for a dream country residence. Next, we're heading to Rutland and the desirable village of Liddington. With two good schools, a busy village hall and two pubs both serving highly rated food, it's a great spot for families. It's also located 15 minutes drive from Corby's fast train connections to London. Also found in this traditional ironstone village is the 12th century bead house. This listed attraction, which is now open to the public, was once a wing of a palace belonging to the Bishops of Lincoln. It served as an almshouse from 1600 until 1930. In the centre of the village is our second property, another beautiful ironstone residence.
It's lovely.
Really striking, isn't it, as you come up to the driveway through the gates.
It's
wonderful. And then the gorgeous, gorgeous old windows and all the features that look to have been maintained really well.
And nice to have a gated drive as well.
Yes.
Enough off-street parking for all the friends and family?
Yeah, plenty.
Just. Should we get in and have a look?
Yeah, great.
Yeah, definitely.
This pretty detached cottage was built in the 17th century and has been beautifully maintained. We're starting our tour in the generous sitting room.
Come through into your main living space.
Wow. This is lovely.
That's fantastic.
And two fireplaces.
Yeah. Big ingle nook. And then you've got your log burner as well.
Fantastic.
It manages to somehow combine being really light, bright and airy with being really cosy.
Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah. Lots of character. I like the beams as well.
Having seen it from the outside, I don't understand quite how there's so much space inside, but there really is.
Well, there's a lot of space, which you can use in a variety of ways. Behind you, just one of two staircases in the property. So it's a really interesting layout at the moment.
Mm. Yeah.
And it'd be really interesting to see how you would choose to live in it.
Excellent.
Shall we see more?
Yeah, great. Yeah.
Okay.
The sitting room occupies nearly the whole width of this property, with the rest of the house unfolding to the rear. The kitchen can be accessed via the sitting room, which then leads through to a large sunroom, next to which is a utility area and WC. Right at the back of the property is the dining room, with the second staircase. Dual aspect overlooking the garden, this long and light reception space lies just beyond the kitchen.
So come through, step up.
Okay. It's a bit smaller than I would have hoped, I think.
I think for me, the bit in the middle could become your dining area. So when you're eating, you're looking outside, and in the summer, you could have those big double doors open.
Each room is very cosy and very characterful, so it's just how you use it, I think.
But it's definitely a house where I think you can use the space to make it fit your lifestyle.
But it's exciting you.
Yes. Yes.
The possibilities here are...
Yeah, they're good.
This house makes me want to overcome its challenges.
Shall we see more?
Yeah.
Upstairs, there are four good-sized bedrooms, one of which is currently used as a dressing area. In addition, there is a study and a beautifully appointed bathroom. We're heading up the rear staircase, which leads to the main bedroom.
Great.
Goodness.
It's not massive, but it's very pretty. Love the beams again.
Bit of storage behind.
Yep.
Okay. Ensuite.
Great.
Excellent.
This house, I'm sensing, Tris especially, there's something about this that's really appealing to you.
Yeah, so I mean, it's a lovely house. It's not even just charm and character. It just feels like somewhere I could call home. But we need to tick those boxes as well. We've got to have enough room. We've got to have enough storage. And it's just checking if there are the solutions to do that.
Whilst this cottage is clearly charming Tristram, I sense that Victoria is struggling to grasp how the dimensions of this property might work for their growing family.
Garden size, good for you?
Still a bit small. Be fine for children. But yeah, it would be nice to have a little bit more space, I think.
Got a beautiful patio down there for barbecues in the summer.
So when you're looking at this garden space, what are you each thinking about when you're looking at the size of the garden?
I think for me, lots of space for children to play. I had a very big garden growing up and I would quite like to keep chickens, so it might be nice to have a little bit more space.
By the time you put a swing and a climbing frame in, maybe there's not a lot of room left. But it is still very nice and it's got a nice view. Not too overlooked, so yeah, some positives too.
Time to talk price. Who's going to guess what this house is on the market for first?
I think it's on at £685,000.
Tris, what are you going to go for?
Well, I think it's perhaps worth more like £630,000.
You're both over.
Oh.
OK.
This house is on the market for offers in excess of £625,000.
Mm. OK, that makes
a
difference.
That's interesting, yeah.
Does that make it even more exciting? What this house could give you?
There's a lot of space downstairs. I don't think it's used in the way that we would benefit from it most. And perhaps that gives us some flexibility to be a little bit more creative.
Worth having another look round with that budget in mind now?
Yeah, so. Definitely.
Okay, will you do that? We'll catch up in a bit.
Perfect.
Coming in at £25,000 under budget, this 17th century character home comes with four bedrooms, plus a spacious and versatile range of reception rooms and a private garden. All this is just a 15-minute drive from the fast rail connections to London.
This is a total heart overhead house. The minute you come through the front door, it feels like somewhere you could live, and feels to me like somewhere I could raise a family and be really, really happy. It combines period charm and modern convenience wonderfully. It's got a real warmth about it.
It's a really pretty house. It's in a really lovely village, so I think all of that is ticking a lot of boxes. I think Tristram's probably fallen in love with this house a little bit, whereas I'm maybe seeing it as a bit more of a practical issue.
I think this is a wonderful house, and I think, you know, anyone would be lucky to live here, and that means I have to consider it. Whether there are too many practical problems to put it on the final shortlist, I'm not sure yet.
Hi! So a good first day of house hunting.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, that's us wrapped up for the day. Perfect. Time for a swift half. A cheeky half, come on.
Helping Victoria and Tristram from Bromley in southeast London find their dream home in the East Midlands countryside. They have a £650,000 budget to spend on a generous property for their growing family. Still to come, the potential of the mystery house really captures their imagination.
Knock through there, which links into your current kitchen that will be your entrance hall. This whole area becomes a huge kitchen diner.
And I get a taste of a local Leicestershire delicacy that's been revived from a recipe that's hundreds of years old.
Oh, my goodness. Crumbly and creamy all at the same time. Yeah. That is just heaven. Oh, my goodness. And I'm just wondering how many I can carry home. So a really great first day in our property search. Although I think Victoria seemed to favour house number one and Tristram property number two. So let's hope our mystery house can bring our lovely couple together. Although it is going to require a little imagination on their parts.
To maximise the square footage available for their budget, we're going more rural for the mystery property, heading to the village of Stonesby in Leicestershire. This location would mean a 20-minute car journey to the nearest fast train connections to London and a 5-minute drive to the amenities of Waltham-on-the-Wolds. A village with a deli, post office, pub and primary school. Back in Stonesby, which has been protected by a conservation order since the 1970s, there are characterful houses, a village green and a church. Our final property is in the centre of this unspoiled, idyllic village.
Welcome it's your mystery house.
Wow. It's incredible. Beautiful. Really interesting. Lovely old stone.
It's the mystery house. So we've brought you a little more rural.
Yeah.
It's a conservation village.
Right.
Which means nothing else is going to get built here.
Perfect.
Oh, wow, okay.
It was originally a farmhouse. Lots of original features have been kept. So a great past, currently a lovely family home, could potentially be your future.
Great.
Well, you're probably wondering why it's the mystery house.
Yeah.
A little bit of imagination as we walk around this one. You dying to get in there?
Yeah, definitely.
Brilliant, yeah.
Okay. Let's go.
Constructed in 1817, this Grade II listed farmhouse is built on the same limestone seam that runs from the Cotswolds, giving the mystery property a warm honey hue. In true farmhouse style, the main entrance leads on into the kitchen.
Come in.
Wow.
Here you are. Beautiful farmhouse kitchen.
It's fantastic. Great size.
Good space.
And a range cooker at the back.
Nice warm feeling when you come in here, isn't it?
Really.
Lovely stone pillars there as well, keeping that consistency of the view from the outside into the kitchen. It's lovely doors out onto the garden there, yeah.
Which really works when you've got a little one.
It does.
So it's a good kitchen space for you.
Great.
Definitely.
Keen to see more?
Definitely. Yes.
Come through into the main living room.
Nice.
Lovely.
Now we've passed what could be a snug next door or children's playroom.
Playroom, I think, yeah.
And this could be adult space, end of the day, glass of something lovely, dual fuel burner there.
Perfect, yeah. It's not the biggest living room, but it doesn't need to be if you've got the extra space to have a playroom and have the kids' toys somewhere else.
Loads of charm, loads of character about it. Lots of really solid features as well.
So the outside of the mystery house you loved?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Downstairs is getting a thumbs up as well.
Yes. Yeah.
Let's see if the upstairs space does the same.
Great.
Set over three levels, the mystery property has four bedrooms spread over the two upper floors. Right at the top is a bedroom with its own WC. On the floor below are the other bedrooms and a family bathroom. At the top of the staircase is the master bedroom.
And into what would be the master bedroom.
Wow.
It's nice, maybe not as big as it could be. I think we would need quite a lot of storage in here as well, so we'd have to work out where everything went. Like the fire, like the floor.
I think you could modernise and use it. I think there's room in this alcove to maybe put in some nice, tasteful, built-in wardrobing. I love the window and the really thick walls that gives it that depth of character.
So would it work for you as a master bedroom?
We could definitely live with it, but it's not my favourite of the masters that we've seen so far.
Okay, well, let's head outside. More to see of this mystery house. And of course, we've got to talk price.
Although this old farmhouse once occupied many acres of land, it now sits on a plot that's a third of an acre. There's lots of space here for Victoria's dream of keeping animals. The current owners use it for animal boarding, specializing in rabbits and guinea pigs. But our mystery house still has more to offer.
So come out into the garden because there is so much to see here. I know you wanted a big garden.
Yep.
So as well as the lawned area, what also belongs to you is behind this hedge, you've got a gravelled area, but you could take the hedge out and just lawn the whole thing.
It's good space.
Liking that?
Space, yeah. And nice to have all the paved area as well for barbecues and that kind of thing.
Really contained, so you're not constantly worrying where the kids are. They can play with some freedom.
Now, remember I said you might need to use your imagination with the mystery house.
Yeah.
Well, this barn also comes with the property and has planning permission already to create either a dream kitchen or living room space on a ground floor. And a second floor with that perfect dream master bedroom and ensuite.
Excellent.
What do you think this property it's on the market for?
I think 635.
£635,000.
Yeah.
I think the house is going to be on the market at £560,000.
This property is currently on the market for £585,000. £1,000.
Okay. So it does give us some money left over to do the work.
You could build something really fantastic in that barn, and you've got a wonderful garden and a great house.
Well, now you know what the house is on the market for. Why don't you take another look around our mystery property? And yeah, there seems to be lots to talk about.
Great.
Definitely.
Leaving plenty to spare from the budget, this three-storey 18th century mystery farmhouse benefits from a traditional country kitchen, plus two further reception areas and four bedrooms. In addition to the third of an acre garden, there's a large barn ripe for conversion, subject to planning permission.
Goodness.
Wow. What a big space.
It's fantastic. Knock through there, which links into your current kitchen that will be your entrance hall. This whole area becomes a huge kitchen diner. Then lots of height to put a floor in. Great big master suite on top. You put glass doors and glass walls all the way along here onto your patio.
The mystery house has got more potential than I could ever have imagined. It's beautiful, it's got loads of space, and I think if you did the barn conversion properly, I think it could be really incredible.
I think it's a really lovely house. I think the village is much quieter here, and it would mean that we'd be in a car to go out for anything, including going to school or going to the shop. So that would be a compromise for us.
The house in itself is certainly wonderful and really attractive. That lifestyle of having to get in the car every day to drop the kids off at school, I'm not so sure.
Wow, bet this house has given you plenty to think about, hasn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
Oh. Come on then, let's find somewhere for a chat.
Leicestershire's lush fields of green are the foundation for the county's gastronomic produce. And whilst in this region, I'm taking time to visit Sparkenhoe Farm to meet a farming couple who have revived a 300-year-old recipe for the region's most famous cheese, Red Leicester. David Clark and his wife Jo started producing this local variety 12 years ago to diversify their dairy farm. They are now the only producers of Leicester cheese made with unpasteurised milk in the country. Although it's an icon of the local area, until now, Red Leicester hadn't been made on a Leicestershire farm since 1956.
David, great to see you.
Hello, Margarita.
How long have your family been farming here?
On this farm, my father and his uncle bought this farm in the early 70s, but prior to that, we've been farming for generations in this area.
And over all those generations, has dairy farming changed much?
It's changed a lot. I can remember getting in the way of my father, who was rolling a churn down the old cow shed many years ago. We built a new milking parlour here in the early 70s, and it's progressed on from that.
Why was it so important for you as a dairy farmer to diversify?
Well, at the time, we were only getting about 18 pence a litre for our milk, and I would have liked 25 pence a litre. So we decided we'd got to do something. So we looked into all sorts of different things, from having horses on livery basis. We did a bit of bed and breakfast at the time as well. But we decided that we wanted to go into cheese because it seemed such a wonderful thing to do. And I'm really pleased we did. It's been a good thing.
Today, the entire cheese-making process takes place at the farm. Fresh, unpasteurised milk is pumped every evening from the milking parlour to the creamery. The next morning, it's mixed with curds and whey. The orange colouring comes from the natural plant dye, annatto, which was first added in the 18th century to make Leicestershire cheese stand out from other pale yellow cheeses. The mixture is compressed for 2 days before it's larded. David's wife, Jo, is showing me how it's done.
What is larding?
Our cheese matures for 8 months. So it needs to be protected in that time. So we put a very fine layer of lard on it and a muslin bandage and cloth, and that will then protect it. So it's just a very, very old-fashioned way of maturing cheese. So I'm just going to wipe the cheese, pat it dry, really, and then we'll put a little bit of lard on
just
the surface.
Just by hand?
Just by hand, yeah. You can help me if you'd like.
OK, and
then
hands
then
washed.
We'll rub it
then,
in.
Oh, my God, it's like
that's
massaging
it.
The cheese.
It is. It's good fun. We do everything by hand. We can't compete with the supermarket cheese, so we have to make sure everything we do is really, really authentic. So this is now the muslin cap. Mm-hmm. So we'll put that on. So if you want to smooth that
down. And the lard can go on top of this as well?
Yes, and then
as you
thin
smooth.
Layer of lard.
OK. And the recipe for your particular cheese, how far back does that go?
It's hundreds of years. When we decided we were going to make a traditional Leicester cheese, because no one else was making it, a lot of the older generation bought us little books with the recipes in that were written in pencil. So we sort of based our recipe on that, really.
And what gives the Sparkenhoe its extra special flavour?
I think the fact that it's handmade. And we use our own cow's milk and pasteurised milk.
And what difference does that make?
It creates a better flavour profile. So when you actually taste the cheese, you're not getting one hit of one flavour. You'll get the unfolding of different flavours throughout the tasting of the cheese.
Once larded, Jo leaves the cheese to age for at least 6 months. The longer it's left to mature, the stronger the taste.
Oh, so, my goodness, this is what we've been waiting for.
It is, yes. So this is a cheese here that we made 8 months ago.
It's... Ooh, the finished product.
There we go.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness.
Can you taste it?
Crumbly and creamy all at the same time. Yeah. That is just heaven. Oh, my goodness. And I'm just wondering how many I can carry home.
Not many. They are heavy.
Maybe I'll just have to eat them here.
What a treat it is to see traditional recipes being revived on their home turf and with such delicious results. So a really good couple of days house hunting and three strong contenders. But I have to admit, I'm not sure which one is their favourite. Let's find out. So after a couple of great days of house hunting, where are we at now? What's your next move?
Property One is definitely the favourite. I think the character there was great, but also the rooms were really big, there was lots of space. It gave us a lot of flexible options as a family.
So what's the next step?
I think we need to see a few others to make sure we're not missing anything and it is the best fit for us that's available at the moment. But assuming nothing changes, I think we go and have a second look at house number one.
And are you both in agreement on that?
Yeah, definitely. I can't wait to go back and think about how we might use it, what we might do. Yeah, be good to see it again.
And I get the sense that our search has really helped focus the priorities that you're after.
I think whilst we don't want to be in town, we do want to keep all those things fairly close at hand. Having a community that we can be part of and that 20 minutes or so to a mainline train station.
And some of the villages that we've looked at, you hadn't considered before.
I don't think we'd looked in those areas previously. And actually, they're such beautiful villages and have so much charm that it would be lovely to find a house somewhere like that.
Well, wish you all the best in your search. And please do let us know how it goes.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
I'm really pleased that our search has helped crystallise for Victoria and Tristram what it is they're after in their new property, and that we've opened their eyes to the style of property that they might consider living in. I look forward to seeing how it goes if they do go back for that second viewing, and we wish them all the best for their future move. I'll see you next time on Escape to the Country.
If you would like to escape to the country in England, Wales, Northern Ireland or Scotland and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.